meetings person we have is Mr. David McMacken, who affectionately goes by the title of the Entrepreneur of History. And this evening's talk will be concerning Wright Avenue Park, the musical bands, the gazebo that used to be here, and other aspects that helped make this park a focal point in Alma of about a century ago. David?
Thank you, Brian. I have just a couple things I want to say before I actually truly begin. One of those is, if you can't see me, feel free to move. That won't bother me. And if you can't hear me, please wave your hand or move up a little closer. That won't bother me either. The other thing is that this is going to be videotaped and probably will be on the local channel. You may find it more interesting than the talk, because the plan is to intersperse some pictures, photos of some of the things that I'll be talking about tonight, things that are not actually available for us to see tonight. Also, I need to make some acknowledgments. There are some people that helped make this talk possible. One of those is Louise Davenport, who helped me with information. Another is the late Mildred Smith, who I had written some material that I found useful. Kathy Hum of the Gratiot County Historical Society also was very generous in helping. And Ruth Hooper and Doris Amsbury also provided me with some information. And all these people, thank you very much for helping me. And I hope that it will help you have a better appreciation of this particular place. On a summer day in 1883, a man boarded a train in Saratoga Springs, New York. He was bound for a distant and somewhat primitive village in the central part of Michigan, the village he had never seen. It was a village with promise, and it was a village that was caught in an unexpected but spectacular building boom. We don't know the day or the hour that the man arrived. One of the local papers probably mentioned it, but we don't have those papers anymore from 1883. We don't know where the man stayed. We don't know his name. We don't know what he looked like. All we know is that he was French, and we know that what he did for a living. He was a professional gardener, a landscape architect, if you will, from the most famous health spa in the country, Saratoga Springs. A spa of healing waters, of huge hotels, of beautiful homes, elaborate gardens, and a very famous horse racetrack. The Frenchman had come to Alma to design this park. We look at the park today and we say, design. When was there ever a design to the park? But it's changed so much, and that's part of our story tonight. The Frenchman came here at the request of Mr. Am I Wright? He was Alma's richest citizen, multimillionaire lumberman, a banker, railroad builder, retailer, entrepreneur extraordinaire. Mr. Wright had come to Alma from Saginaw in the early 1880s, and he had arrived in a mood to build, and he began immediately. Downtown at the main intersection, the Opera House block, containing five stores with this very beautiful Opera House upstairs, was built. Mr. Wright's new roller mill was grinding local wheat. The three-story Wright Hotel was under construction. His brickyard south of town was supplying brick for most of these buildings. Am I Wright was changing the face of Alma. But it resumed the following spring. Plans were underway for the other major part of the project, the building. But the building was delayed for a year because the lumber market was glutted in 1884. And lumberman Wright was not exactly sure what his prospects would be. He was a little uneasy in times of economic instability, and so he delayed the building. But in January of 1885, farmers began hauling stone for the foundation of the Alma Springs Sanitarium. They probably brought the stone in, came up State Street, perhaps came up this street, dumped the stone right over here because it's in this vacant lot next to the Wilcox Nursing Home that this building was going to be constructed. The impressive building was under construction for a year and a half. And when it first accepted patients in the fall of 1886, it offered baths and treatments for every illness imaginable. They claimed to cure virtually everything except insanity. Before it was over, this sanitarium, a very large and elegant building which underwent several expansions, treated a whole diverse collection of people. Montana ex-governor Ashley, friend of Lincoln and one of the guiding lights in the Ann Arbor Railroad. Philip Studebaker from the great Studebaker Buggy Works in South Bend. And little Jake Seligman, a very flashy salesman and store owner from Saginaw. These are some of the famous. Some people came here and died here. The cure didn't work for them. But whether it was a famous person or the not so famous, they came to take the water cure. Part of the recommended regimen here was exercise. And with the park, there was exercise available. It had lawn, tennis courts, shady trees, walking paths, swings, hammocks, croquet courts, and it allowed those Victorians to get the exercise that was recommended. Picture, if you will, ladies in their long dresses, gentlemen in suits, coming down from the veranda, a very large, long, beautiful veranda, on the sanitarium, to the street, down the walk, into the park, strolling right where we are now. Strolling was an art back then, sort of a landlocked version of promenading the deck of an ocean liner. And they knew how to bring strolling to a high level of perfection. Horse-drawn carriages and riding horses were also available to those people who wanted to ride through the park. Some had to, as we would say back then, take the air, get out and get some fresh air. And some risked everything at lawn tennis, especially ladies with their long dresses. Some spent hours at croquet, but all were seeking better health at the Alma Springs Sanitarium. Wright's interest in Alma did not flag. Development of the normal school was underway, and within a year it became Alma College. It was soon, his stone house rose on State Street, the largest, most elegant building in town, still standing over here on the corner. Alma was booming, developing faster than citizens could imagine, and they, especially the chewers and spitters, only wondered what new project would spring from the mind of Am I Right? Now, one of the additions to the town was not a building, and it did not spring from the mind of Am I Right? Sometime in 1883, we don't know the exact time, Al Yerington, a local druggist and musician, formed a brass band of 12 pieces that lent an air of excitement to the village. Ithaca already had a band, but for the dedication of the hotel, Mr. Wright had had to import a band, as you recall. With the formation of the Alma Brass Band, Mr. Wright would have to import no more bands for his occasions. Al Yerington gathered amateur musicians from all walks of life, but he benefited from his own family, which was musically inclined. He was joined by his brother George, and shortly by his brother Charles, who had studied brass and strings at the Chicago Musical Seminary. Playing for various occasions, the Alma Brass Band gained both popularity and players. Having presented concerts in the Opera House, it changed its name to the Wright's Opera House Band and was on its way to becoming one of the finer amateur bands in the state. For most of its life, the band numbered around 20 members. Most played brass or drums, although a woodwind or a string sneaked in once in a while. Concertmaster Will Kelly was a dentist. Seely Amsbury, who played the piccolo, among other instruments, was a farmer. So was his brother Fred Amsbury, who played the trumpet. Both Amsbury brothers were part of a family orchestra that included three other brothers and a sister. George and Frank Harrington owned a table factory. George played the bass drum, Frank played the trumpet. Byron Webb, local druggist, was also a trumpeter. Nick Davidson, a barber, and DeWitt Vaught, a painter, both played baritones. and Art Amsden, local printer on one of the papers, played the trumpet. Art Amsden, of all the members of the Wright's Opera House band, he was the one who made musical history. He had come to Alma from Lyons, Michigan, where as a youth he'd been a member of the Lyons Municipal Band. He loved music, yet he feared he couldn't make a living as a musician. So he learned the printing trade, and that's what he followed here in Alma. Soon, however, he left Alma and the Wright's Opera House Band and was off to the New England Conservatory of Music. Eventually, Amsden was director of a 30-piece band in Saginaw. His musical career took him across the country, and his influence in Saginaw helped organize the Eddie Band, which plays even this summer Sunday evening concerts in Saginaw. Such a musician was Amsden that he could play two trumpets at a time, playing a different tune on each. He played Yankee Doodle on one and Sailor's Hornpipe on the other. He could also hold sustained harmonies on two cornets while he hummed a bass sounding like a third. And Art Amsden played in the Wright's Opera House Band. But of course, so did Charles Yerington, and he made musical history in Gratiot County. He taught business and penmanship briefly at Alma College, then accepted an offer from St. Louis to start a college in a large vacant building that they had on the hill across from the downtown, across the mill pond. So Yerington's college was begun, and both Charles and his wife Annabel, who was an accomplished pianist, began teaching music classes as well as the business classes that was really establishing Yerington's college in St. Louis. Charles Yerington then organized a Yerington's College band, a brass band of accomplished young musicians. It was an age of music at a time when there were few diversions, no TV, no radio, no movies, few amusement parks. Many young people turned to music. And many of the male musicians in Alma ended up in Wright's Opera House Band. And many of the female vocalists sang to accompany the band, or the band sang to accompany the vocalist at different times and different concerts here in the town. This band was scheduled to be in every parade, whether for Memorial Day, the 4th of July, or some other special occasion. For the laying of the cornerstone of the Central Michigan Normal School in 1886, the band was to lead the parade and play two numbers at the ceremony. As I recall from reading about it, the parade got hit by a very severe thunderstorm and it sort of disintegrated, but the ceremony was eventually held. Besides concerts at the Opera House, the band greeted dignitaries at the depot and escorted them to the hotel. In 1886, for instance, Cyrus Luce and Senator Palmer arrived in Alma. They were met by Am I Wright and a delegation. They were brought into town to the hotel in carriages, and at the hotel they were serenaded by the Wright's Opera House Band. The next week, Cyrus Luce was elected governor of Michigan. By 1887, the band was being directed by Art Amsden. In February, the band gave a fine concert in the Opera House, and this performance included a comedy number complete with fireworks and acrobatics. Afterwards, 25 couples remained for a social dance. The proceeds from the dance were $40, and they went into the fund for new uniforms. Dark trousers and dark cutaway coats with small brimmed pillbox hats had been the uniform for several years. Now the band needed uniforms worthy of its growing reputation, and the fundraising was underway. Meanwhile, on Friday nights, this band moved here into the Sanitarium Park for open-air concerts. The guests at the Sanitarium were invited, as well as the townspeople. People came from the Sanitarium and streamed into the park to sit under the trees and listen to the open-air free concerts of the Wright's Opera House Band. They sat on blankets, they sat in chairs. There were many benches in the park at that time. They sat in hammocks and swings, and they basically just enjoyed themselves in the evening. Am I Right, within a year or so, installed an electrical generating plant so that he could have electricity in the hotel, in the sanitarium, and in his home. And he asked his workmen to string lights through the trees in the sanitarium park so that the evening concerts could be illuminated. This started a tradition that lasted for a number of years. Then he directed that a bandstand or a gazebo should be built, apparently quite a large and elaborate one for the band, and the band literally stepped up a step or two, and the concerts continued. Now in August of 1887, the new uniforms arrived. They cost $500, that's total, friends, and had been paid for by the townspeople. Band members now sported gray pants with a dark stripe down the leg, gray cutaway coats with three rows of gold buttons down the front, and nickel-plated helmets topped with red ostrich plumes. Parading down the street, the Wright's Opera House band was such a spectacle that the old dudes forgot to chew, let alone spit, and little boys resolved to practice their instruments if they could ever wear clothes like that. Now, you would think that after a century, there wouldn't be much left of Wright's Opera House band. As far as I know, people, none of the participants are alive. But we still have at least one vestige of the band, and I'm very grateful to the Gratiot County Historical Society for loaning me something that belonged to Celia Amsbury, one of the band members. And it is here, and from where you are, you won't get a good look at it. And if you would like to look at it afterwards, please look only. No fingers, but take a peek at it. It is a kind of an unusual and very flashy piece of clothing. This is Celia Amsbury's new uniform. He apparently was not very large. Okay. And the buttons all have a musical motif. This, I think, is wool. It's in just excellent condition. Members of the family donated it to the Gratiot County Historical Society. They've kept the moths out of it down through the years. It's wool, and they wore this in the summer in all the parades. Okay, you can just use your imagination. But looks like it just came right straight from the seamstress. Late in August of 1887, there were competing fire companies from neighboring towns. It's like the fire departments got together for competition. I think it was Ithaca, Alma, St. Louis, Mount Pleasant, and I believe Lakeview. And at these contests, they had hose carts, and their teams would grab these carts and race down the street to see who could get from here to there fastest. They sprayed water, too, to see who could man the pumps and make the stream go the farthest. This was an annual event, and it was a big deal. And the Wright's Opera House band was there to be in the parade, along with the bands from other towns. On September 14th, 1887, as the 35 students of the first class of Alma College assembled in the chapel for their very first opening service, the Wright's Opera House band was there. They played an opening number and closed the program with Home Sweet Home, and as the paper said, played with variations. As winter approached, the Opera House band rented the skating rink for the season, the roller skating rink. And that promised to people of Alma skating and music and dances for the season. And then the band announced a grand masquerade for January 2nd, 1888. As you might expect, it was a huge success. And so the Wright's Opera House Band went on for a number of years, eventually fading, but setting a precedent that has produced a number of marching and concert bands in Alma down through the years. The spirit of the amateur musicians of Wright's Opera House Band alive yet today. But perhaps of all their concerts, all the playing that they did, the marching that they did in parades, nothing was quite so popular as the concerts here, right where we are, in the Sanitarium Park. If you listen closely, maybe you can hear some of those notes still ringing in the air. The sounds going out to the people beyond the park, even to the people who are still downtown. The talented Wright's Opera House Band playing with joy, enthusiasm, and finesse, embedding itself into the history of this town. But back to the park. In 1895, Mr. Wright began construction of a large home for his daughter and son-in-law, Sarah and Henry Lancashire. The house was called Sarah Villa, and its grounds extended 600 feet from State Street back along the north edge of the park. The great stone fence that walled off the Lancashire property from the park still is at the north end and can be seen as you look right now. Stone parapets with wrought iron sections between were just the temptation kids needed to climb. What was over that fence? And if they climbed up and looked, they would see the gardens, regular vegetable gardens of the Lancashires, the formal flower gardens, perhaps the tennis courts, and also the stable where the Lancashires at first kept their horses, and then after the turn of the century, their very expensive cars among the first in Alma. By 1905, it was clear that mineral baths were no longer so much in vogue, and the sanitarium was closed. Mr. Wright, now in his 80s, gave the sanitarium park to the city. And he gave the empty sanitarium building to the Masonic Lodge of Michigan so that they could use it as an old folks' home since their home in Grand Rapids had recently burned. In 1912, Mr. Wright died, but his park lived on. And in 1913, the park, named in his honor, was the site of Alma's first Chautauqua, a week of what may be described as culture for the masses under the big top. The Chautauqua Institution contracted with towns throughout Michigan and the Midwest to provide a week-long series of cultural programs. Promotion of Chautauqua was intense. Parades of cars decorated with flowers and bunting traveled through the countryside. Ads with photos were placed in the local newspapers. Posters aroused the interest of Alma citizens who could buy a season ticket for $2. Then the big tent went up right here in this corner of Wright Park. I don't know precisely where it was, but you may be sitting under where it was. People came down the walk from State Street to enter the Chautauqua grounds and to come into the tent. The east end of the tent was filled with chairs. The stage was in the west end. Three daily sessions were presented, one for children in the morning, a general session in the afternoon, a general session in the evening. What did people see and hear at Chautauqua? In 1914, just as an example, Chautauqua provided several lecturers, the Dunbar Bell Ringers, Marcus Kellerman, baritone, and the Ben Greet players who performed Shakespeare's Twelfth Night, and lots of other things. 900 tickets were sold by the ladies of the Civic Improvement League. That was 150 more than they were obligated to sell by contract. Let's take 1917 as another example. Dr. Charles Baker came and lectured on efficiency. Frankly, that sounds pretty boring, but I guess it was interesting to people back then. And a lecturer named Gatling Gun Fogelman, who could speak 300 words a minute, lectured on salesmanship. Dr. George McNutt, who had labored with the working man and become a Presbyterian minister, spoke on labor. And the oratoric artist, a mixed quartet of noted singers, performed, and the Mikado Light Opera Company performed, as you might expect, the Mikado. They turned the stage into an oriental garden with many Japanese lanterns, and Ed Andrews, who played Kiko, had already played the part 1,200 times. That year, moving pictures were part of Chautauqua for the first time. And at the Mother Goose Festival for Kids, costume characters stepped out of a large book on the stage. Antonio Sala, a noted Spanish cellist, performed, and the lovely American Indian princess, Wata Waso, dressed in her native garb, told the stories of her people. In the mid-20s, plays such as Maxwell Anderson's World War I drama, What Price Glory, came to the stage here in the park. And musical comedies such as 45 Minutes from Broadway and the comedy Adam and Eva, Bachman's Million Dollar Band, Reno the Magician, and the Werahiko Rawi, the Polynesian raconteur who spoke on Uncle Sam's Samoan Islanders, along with Middleton's mannequins who danced, sang, and did pantomime, all appeared under the big top right here at this particular spot. A large variety of performers and performances graced the stage in the Chautauqua years. There were puppet shows, chalk talks, storytellers, magic shows, weavers, pottery makers, and glass blowers. There were popular speakers, dramas galore, and musical presentations of top quality. People say not much is going on in Alma today, and I agree. Alma was a town right from its very beginnings that was interested in culture. It was on the Red Path Chautauqua circuit for 18 years until Chautauqua died in the Depression. And the excitement rose each year as the people anticipated the erection of the great Chautauqua tent right here in Wright Park, culture under the big top. But the park has seen many changes, and many of you have seen it change. In the 1920s, near us here, it had, in some area at least, it had a waterfowl pond surrounded by a black wrought iron fence, and inside were ducks and geese and swans. At the same time, a building was erected for small animals. Located over at the east side of the park, it had peacocks, small deer, raccoons, a badger, prairie chickens, and guinea hens. Alma people were angered when mischievous boys one night let their dog loose in the deer pen. It scared one of the favorite does, named Beauty, out of the pen. She was later spotted way beyond Bridge Street. The very day that people were upset, another one of the does had a fawn, to everyone's delight. In the 1920s, the cut stone monument over there to Mr. Wright was erected, containing drinking fountains. Around 1950, the first framed building in Alma, which stood originally where the Alma Hardware stands today, and then was moved over on the south side of Superior Street, was taken apart board by board and moved into the park. It had been the first, one of the first schools in Alma. Three churches had been started in this frame building, and for a number of years it had served as a blacksmith shop when it stood on the west side or south side of Superior Street. Then it was moved into the park, and a lot of history came with those boards. The only problem is, when they kind of had the idea that they would build it again as an historic blacksmith shop complete with Lee Leibolt's tools, it never got built. And no one seems to know what happened to Lee Leibolt's blacksmith tools or the boards of the first framed building. They were here and then they were gone. Playground equipment has varied through the years. The park has fewer trees now, probably, than in any time since it was first established. The great elms that shaded a good deal of the park were victims of Dutch elm disease, and they were felled about perhaps 20 years ago. I was living on State Street, and I remember the day when those diseased elms were finally brought down with the chainsaws. Bands other than Wright's Opera House Band have given concerts in the park. Most recently, the Jazz Ensemble of Mid-Michigan followed in a century-old tradition in presenting its program of big band music. Countless family reunions, picnics by the thousands, ice skating in winter, tennis in summer, a million things have happened in this park. Parades have formed up here. In the 20s, the Illinois Farmers Picnic, begun by farmers who had come here from Illinois, might attract 1,000 people to this park. And down through the years, each person who came, whether for a concert or to attend the Chautauqua, or simply to enjoy a picnic, or to just be alone, has carried away a certain memory, a certain impression of this place, just as all of you tonight will carry away new knowledge and new memories of this special spot in Alma, this remarkable park, the dream of Am I Right and his French gardener. Thank you. But there will be